I hope my screen is visible to you.
Yes, we are seeing.
So this particular class we'll start off with CSS. Okay, so we'll first of all go with introduction to CSS, color, text and boxes. So this is especially for you, my dear students and young researchers. And you can reach me at dr.mr.anand@gmail.com. So, thank you God for giving me this golden opportunity to deliver this useful session, to share my knowledge, to share my ideas, to share my experience among my fellow national, international participants, students and young scientists. So this particular class we will discuss more about the introduction about CSS, how you understand CSS, CSS associates, styles and rules with HTML elements, example and outputs, and how to introduce the CSS, and then about foreground color, which means color plays a vital role. Color, in color we discuss more about the foreground color as well as the background color. And we'll discuss the outputs as well as the example and output of color. And then the second part of today's class we'll discuss more about the introduction to text, the type-based terminology and the techniques, the various other techniques which offer a wide range of typefaces, the example and output of text, the box dimensions, height and width, and then in the case of border, margin and padding. And then we'll discuss some example and output of boxes, and finally we'll have some independent work. I think I've already posted this independent work yesterday in the Google Classroom, and we will have some short videos to explain our particular topics. So we are starting off with an introduction to CSS. So as you can see, CSS allows you to create rules to specify how the content can appear. Okay, for example, you can specify the background of the page, maybe in cream color. All the paragraph should appear in gray color using this ARIA typeface. Or because maybe you can also specify in another way, which means that you can specify like all level 1 heading should be in blue or maybe italic. And typeface as well. Right. So this is how you are going to display. For example, as a level of heading, or maybe as a level of formatting, maybe color, or maybe font style, maybe italic, or maybe Times typeface, maybe Times New Roman. You can actually display the way you want. For example, in this example you have like from garden to plate displayed in pink color, and this one maybe in maybe black color. Okay, and what to plant again in pink color. Okay, and this paragraph again in black color. So you can see like this one is maybe bolded as well as it appears as a heading, and this one it is slightly lesser than this one. Okay, so you can call this as one as a H2 tag. Okay, right. So this is H1 tag and this is H2 tag. And you can also change the color of the text also, maybe to gray even. So understanding CSS, so the key to understanding how CSS works is to imagine that there is a invisible box around every HTML element. So you have to imagine this way, okay. So normal HTML element, you imagine there is an invisible box around every HTML element. So on this page you can see a basic HTML page. In the maybe the next page you will see the same HTML page, but we have added some outlines to each of the elements so that you can see how CSS will treat each element as if it lives inside its own box. Okay. For example, this one can be created using the H1, maybe the HTML elements. Okay, so this one, like the cottage garden, it is being displayed in maybe bold as well as very higher heading. Okay, the other ones you will have maybe cottage garden displayed in italic, and the other ones normally. Okay, the England is actually underlined. So this one, maybe English estate gardens is underlined. So this one, I think we can display using HTML tags. We'll discuss the usage of CSS maybe in the next page. Okay, so CSS allows you to create rules. Okay, you can control the way that each individual box is being presented, also the contents of the box is being presented. Okay, so here the block level elements are shown with the red borders, and inline elements have green borders. Okay, I'll show you with an example. The block level elements are shown with red borders, and inline elements have green borders. Okay. So here the body element creates the first box, then H1, H2, paragraph, maybe I tag as well as A elements, which create their own boxes within H1. So using CSS, you could add a border around any of the boxes. Maybe you can specify the width and height of the box, or maybe you can add a background color to it. Okay. You could also control the text inside the box. For example, the color of the text you can control, color of the box you can control, size and the typeface you use in the text. So everything you can format it. Okay, right. So as I told you, the block level elements are shown with red borders. Okay, block level elements are shown with red borders, and the inline elements have green borders. For example, cottage garden, England, English estate garden. So this is displayed in maybe green or maybe blue. Okay. So CSS associates style rules with HTML elements. So CSS works by associating rules with HTML elements. These rules generally govern the idea of how the content of specific elements should be displayed. Okay. For example, a CSS contains two parts. For example, a selector and a declaration. Selector means you have the P tag. Okay. P and then start brace. Font family. Okay. You give it as A. Okay. So this is actually declaration part. You are declaring the font family to be Arial. Okay. So this rule includes that all P elements, P tag elements, should be shown with the Arial typeface. Okay. So here the selector generally indicate which element the rule applies to. Okay, so the same rule can apply to more than one element also if you separate the element names with commas. Okay. So generally it indicates which element the rule applies to. Okay. And then with the case of declaration, they indicate how the elements referred to in the selector should be styled. Okay. So generally the declarations are split into two parts, one a property and then the other one is a value. Okay, and they are separated by a colon. Okay, so this is property. Okay, and this is value. Property is font family and value is area. Okay. So you can say that CSS declarations sit inside the curly brackets, and each is made up of two parts, maybe property and values, that's what I said, separated by a colon. You can specify several properties in one declaration, each separated by a semicolon. So we have like H1, H2 and H3, and we have the font family Arial, color as yellow. Okay, so this is actually property, this is value, this is property, this is value. So property is font family, value is Arial. Property is color, value is yellow. Okay. So this rule indicates that all H1, H2 and H3 elements should be shown in the Arial typeface in a yellow color. Okay. So here the properties indicate the aspects of the element you want to change. For example, color, font, width, height and border. You can change the various properties. And values specify the settings you want to use for the chosen properties. For example, if you want to specify a color property, then the value is actually the color you want the text in these elements to be. Okay, so you can specify, you know, the color, okay, like yellow or maybe orange or maybe green. Okay, accordingly you can specify these values in the properties. So this is an example of how you introduce CSS. Like you start off with exclamatory symbol, doc type HTML, and then you have like HTML tag, head tag, and title you have like introducing CSS, and then the link hence reference you have the CSS example, okay, type as text, okay, and style sheet, you have a slash head, you're going to close this head, and then you start the body. H1 is the highest heading, okay, so from garden to plate, and then you have the paragraph tag, okay, yay, and then in italics you have potager, okay, it's a French term for an ornamental vegetable or kitchen garden, okay, and then you close the P tag, and then H2 is the second level of heading, subheading, what to plant, okay, and then you have the paragraph, okay, and then close body, close H2. So here the body, this is actually you are going to specify the property as well as value, okay, like, so font, family, Arial, word and a sans serif. Okay, so this is the value you are giving for the font family. And H1, H2, the color you are going to give as this one. Okay. And for the paragraph, you have the color to be this one. Okay. So you are specifying different colors for headings, H1, H2, and then separate color for paragraph. So as I told you, from garden to plate is actually displayed in pink. Okay, this is the highest level heading, and the subheading is what to plant. Okay, this is also displayed in pink, but the paragraph is displayed in maybe black or maybe green. So you have the color property, what you call to be the foreground color. So in the foreground color, the color property allows you to specify the color of the text with inside a element. Okay, so you can specify color in either ways, maybe using RGB values or maybe hex codes or maybe color names. Okay, with the case of RGB values, you should indicate how much red component, how much green component, or how much blue component are used to make it up. Okay, for example, RGB 100 190. Yeah, can you please mute the voice?
I'm not hearing.
It's okay.
Yeah,
I hope my voice is audible to you. Is my voice audible to you?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Shall I continue the session?
Yes.
So the case of RGB, and then as I told you, in the RGB, it is all about how you specify the red component, green component and blue component. So for example, if you are giving 100 190, means first 100 specifies the value of the red component present in it, and second 100 specifies the green component present in it, and 90 specifies the blue component that is present in it. So this is how you specify the color property. And then in the case of the hex code, actually in the previous program we explained with the help of, or maybe we expressed in the form of hex code, okay, like hash EE3E80, okay, so this is how you express this one. Okay, the same way, like there are 6 digit codes that represent the amount of red, green and blue in a color. To see it, maybe in the front you have a hash sign or maybe a bounce sign. Okay, for example, hash EE3E80, So you specify how much rain, ring and two components are present in this column. Also, you can alternatively specify using column names. So there are 147 predefined color names that are recognized by the browsers. For example, you have a color called dark cyan. Okay, so that's also a color that you can set using the color property. So this one you can use it as a foreground color in your text. Right. So CSS3 has also introduced another way to specify colors. For example, you can use like a HSLA format. So here the CSS allows you to add commands to your CSS files. So anything between the maybe slash star or maybe star slash will not be interpreted by the browser, which means that it will be taking it as a command. So the use of comments can help you to understand the CSS file. You can organize it. You can split the long document into sections. So here you can also use comments, which you can have a method to specify each of the different types of colors. Is the problem fixed over? Because I could see some, hear some more voices.
Yes, teacher, we pass it to bigger computer.
Okay, okay. Can I continue or you are fixing it?
Yes, teacher,
okay.
Can I see your screen?
You cannot see my screen?
Yes.
Okay, can you be able to see my screen?
Yes.
Okay, okay. Okay. So this is the example, as I told you, the color name H1, you are giving the color is dark cyan. Either you can specify in this way as a color name, or maybe in the form of Xcode, you can give it as color hash EE3E80. So this is using Xcode. Or maybe if you are giving us RGB value, then you can give it as color RGB 100 190. So this is RGB, green and blue. Okay, right. So the output is this one, like marine biology. So this is displayed in different color. This is the highest heading, and then you have a subheading composition of seawater. This is again displayed in pink color. And you have a paragraph which is displayed in grey color or maybe black color. Right. Now we are going to discuss more about the background color. So CSS treats each HTML element as if it appears in a box. And background color property sets the color of the background for that box. So you can also specify your choice of the background color. Okay, maybe using RGB values or maybe hex codes or maybe color names. If you do not specify a background color, then it is the background is default set to transparent. Okay, for example, in this example, we see body background color as in the RGB format, RGB 200, 200, 200. So red is 200, green is 200, blue is 200. And then H1, you have background color dark cyan. Okay, so this is using color names. And H2, background color has EE380. So this is using hex code. Okay. And then the paragraph background color is white. So if you have background color as white for paragraph, and H2, the background color is maybe pink. Okay. And H1, the background color is maybe somewhat like a mixture of blue and green. So this is an example of color. So you have excellent free document type of HTML. You start with HTML, start the head tag, and title you give it as color. Style type text CSS. And body you are going to give the background color as silver, color as white, and then adding 20 pixel, and then font family as Arial word in a sensor. And in the case of H1 tag, you give the background color. Okay. And you specify the background color in SSLA format also. The color you are going to give and padding as inherit. Okay. And then you start up with the background in the case of padding 5 pixel. Margin 0 pixel. Okay. And V.0, the background color you are specifying in this RGB format. 230 and 62, 120. So you are going to repeat it for P0, P1, P2, P3, P4, P5, P6, P7, P8 and P9. So you are going to specify the background color in RGB colors. And also P10, P11, P12, P13 and P14. So you are going to specify the background color in RGB format. And then you are going to close the style as well as head. Okay. And in the body, you are going to give the P class. Okay. 14.0, very alkaline. 13.0, 12.0, 11, 10 and up to 0. Okay. 0 means very acidic. 7 means neutral. 14 means very alkaline. Okay. So this is how you specify the PHP with the H1 tags and the P heads. Sorry, I am hearing too much of noise. You see, tell me what.
No, we were just discussing about. Excuse me.
Yeah. Okay, so this is all about something related to chemistry. Okay, like in the case of pH scale. 0 means acidic, 7 means neutral, 14 means very alkaline or base. Okay, right. So you are going to display with the help of different maybe H1 tags and paragraph here. Okay. Finally, you close the body and close the H1. Okay, for example, this is the case. Like a very acidic means it is displayed in dark pink color. Okay, and also it goes, the color goes. Okay, it becomes very light. At 7, it becomes very neutral. Okay, and then like 8, 9, it goes, okay, light the blue color. Okay, 14 means dark, heavy blue color. Okay, and pH scale, the background is actually like a transparent. Okay, so this is how you display the color using the CSS elements. Like you have a box. And you can, the box, you can specify the text color as well as the background color box. Right. So you are going to go with the introduction to text. Here the properties will allow you to control the appearance of the text. It can be split into two groups, which means that one is going to directly affect the font and its appearance. For example, the typeface, whether it is bold or maybe regular or maybe italic. Also the size of the text. Okay. And also the other would have the same effect on the text no matter what font you are using. For example, one is directly affecting the performance, maybe the appearance as well as the font, but the other, no matter what font you display, no matter what appearance you have, it is going to have that effect. So including the color of the text and the spacing between the words and the letters. Okay. So these two properties will allow you to control the appearance of the text, and the formatting of your text can have a significant effect on how readable your pages are. So the typeface terminology, we have serif, sans serif and monospace. Okay, so serif fonts, they have extra details on the ends of the main strokes of the letters. For example, like IM, it appears to be a little more stylish, very neat. Okay, right. In print, serif fonts were traditionally used for long passages of text because they were considered easier to read. Okay, and then you have, in alternative to serif, you have sans serif. Okay, they have straight ends to letters, straight, very straight, and therefore have much cleaner design. Okay. So screens have a lower resolution than print. So if the text is small, sans serif fonts can be clearer to read. Even if the font size is low also, you can read this sans serif font. And then you have monospace. every letter in a mono space or maybe fixed width font is the same width. Okay, right. So everything is of same width. Okay, so non monospace fonts have different widths. Okay, so monospace fonts are commonly used for code. Okay, like maybe in the case of maybe C or maybe C++, okay, Python, you use this monospace fonts for code because they align nicely, okay, making the text easier to follow in the case of a programming code. So this is the typeface terminology in CSS. So you have another example, the XYZ. So you have the ascender above the cap height, okay, and then you have the cap height, okay. You have the X height, the X height, and this is actually the baseline, and you have a descender below the baseline. So you have like weight in the form of light, medium, bold, and black. So the font weight not only adds emphasis but also affects the amount of white space and contrast on page. And you have the style, you have normal, italic, and oblique. Okay, so italic fonts have a cursive aspect to some of the lettering. Oblique font styles take the normal style and put it on an angle. Okay, and then stretch, so everything appears stretched, like condensed. Okay, condensed, okay, to some extent. Regular, okay, to middle level. Extended to the maximum extent. So in condensed or narrow versions of the font, letters are thinner and closer together. In expanded versions, they are thicker and further apart. So this is weight, style, and stretch of the typeface terminology in CSS. So these are the techniques that offer a wide choice of typefaces. We have the font family and font face and service-based font face as well. For example, here the user's computer needs a typeface installed, and CSS is used to specify the typeface. Okay, and with the case of font face, CSS specifies where a font can be downloaded from if it is not installed on the computer. And then service-based font face, commercial service gives users access to a wide range of fonts using the font face. Okay, and the issues with the case of font family, there is a limited choice of typefaces that most users have installed. For the case of font face, the user has to download the font file, which can slow down the loading of the web page. With the case of service-based font face, there is an ongoing fee to cover licenses paid to font firms. With the case of licensing font family, you are not distributing the typeface, so there is no licensing issue. But with the case of font face, the license to use the font must permit its distribution using the font face. And then with the case of service-based font face, the service takes care of licensing issues. Okay, so you need not have to worry about it. And then you have the choice of typefaces. There is a limited choice between the font needs to be installed on the user's computers. And with the case of font face, choice is limited because very few typefaces can be freely distributed this way. Okay. And with the case of service-based font face, each service offers a different size of fonts based on the agreements with the font founders. So this is all about free font family, font faces, and service based font faces. So once again we continue with the case of images, SIFR and FR. You can create a graphic that contains the text as you want it to appear in a different typeface. And with the case of SIFR, we have the font is embedded on a Flash movie, and JavaScript replaces the HTML text with a Flash version. And CUF font, similar to SIFR, it uses JavaScript to create either a SVG or BML version of the text. So the people who use screen readers will rely on the alternate text to know what is in. And SIFR, the method only works if the user has Flash and JavaScript enabled on the device. With the case of CUF font, generally everything is because of JavaScript. Okay, so also users cannot select text, and text can't change when a user hovers removes over it. And with the case of images, you can use any typeface that you can have a license to use on your computer. And with the case of SIFR, many commercial makers of typefaces allow this technique, although you may need to pay for an extra web use license. Cufon, some typeface makers allow use of their fonts with Cufon, but you need to check the license. So how much services offer with the license. And images, we have a very wide choice because you can use any typeface. That's a flexibility that you can have a license for. And with the case of SAFR, the method provides a lot of choice because many of the typeface manufacturers permits this kind of usage. And with the case of Cufon, we have slightly lesser choice for SAFR as some typeface manufacturers are not as keen on this technique. So this is an example of text. We have XML resemble document type HTML. You start the HTML tag, head tag, title is text, style type is text slash CSS, body you are going to start up, padding 20 pixel, H1, H2, H3 and A. You are going to give the font weight as normal and color will be a different color, again margin 0 pixel. Now you are going to define for H1, H2, H3, P.intro, A as well as A.h1. In the case of H1, you are going to give the font family Georgia Times Serif, font size 250%, text shadow you are going to give 2 pixel, 2 pixel, 2 pixel, and you are going to give the color, and padding bottom you are going to give it as 10 pixel. In the case of H2 tag, you are going to give the font family, okay, and font size, text transform uppercase, letter spacing 0.2 cm, and H3 font size 150%, and P tag font family line height color you are going to give it up, and P dot intro first line, okay, so the first line, font weight you are going to give, and credits the font style italic, text align as right, and A you are going to give the text decoration as none, and AH over the text decoration is underlined. So you are going to continue with the case of body, with the case of H1, Briots, H2, this is the second level subheading, a heart wrapped in fur, and then you are going to give the P tag, okay, the you are going to give the reference value, Wikipedia slash Wikipedia Briot. So our merger debris, so you are going to give a definition, okay, and then H3 tag, another level subheading, prehistory, and then you are going to give the paragraph tag, and P class credits by EV jacket, and you are going to close the body as well as system. So in your output you will have this one, the Briots displayed in a different color, like a blue, and it has a shadow, so shadow also has a color, okay, and you have a subheading, a heart wrapped in fur. So this Briot is actually displayed in a color, okay, so this is actually taken from the Wikipedia. Our Berger debris is a definition. Then you have breed history, that's a subheading, and you have a paragraph, and then you have the credits by EV decade. So this one is displayed in the italic, okay, specifically you can say it is oblique, okay, so this is how it is being displayed. So finally we are going to go with the box dimensions with the case of height and width. So by default a box size just big enough to hold its contents. Normally you specify with the help of the width as well as height properties. So the most popular way to specify the size of the box is to use pixels or maybe percentages or maybe EMs, maybe like emphasis type. Okay. So generally pixels have been the most popular method because it generally allows designers to accurately control their size. So in the case of the box, you use like a percentage for the representing the size of the box. So here the size of the box is relative to the size of the browser window, okay, or if the box is encased within another box, it is a percentage of the size of the containing box, okay. So when you use EMS, the size of the box is based on the size of the text within it. So if the size of the text is less, box is also less. Okay. But with other cases like pixels, the size of the box is entirely dependent on the size of the browser window. Okay. But in the case of EMS, the size of the box is based on the size of the text within it. So the designers have recently started to use percentages and EMS more for measurements as they try to create designs that are flexible across the devices which have different size. So a containing div element is used which is 300 pixels wide by 300 pixels high. So this is how you specify the width and height. So there is a paragraph which has 75% of the width and height, and which means that the size of the paragraph is 225 pixels wide by 225 pixels high. So this is an example. You have div plus paragraph, you have a paragraph, okay, and then you close the div HTML tag. And with the case of div box, you specify the height 300 pixel, width 300 pixel, background color you are going to specify, okay, right? And the paragraph tag, height, width and background color. So the background color is actually maybe like gray, okay, and the text is being displayed in black, okay, and the box, okay, the box, you have the height and width like 300 pixel wide and 300 pixel height, and the background color is maybe pink. So this is pink and this is gray, okay. So this is a box within another box. So limiting the width, you are going to specify the min width and maximum width. Some page designs expand and shrink to fit the size of the user screen. So generally you can use minimum width property to specify the smallest size a box can be displayed at when the browser window is narrow. And maximum width property also indicates the maximum width a box can stretch when the browser window is wide. Okay, so using min width property and max width property, you can adjust according to the design. So they are very helpful properties to ensure that the content of the pages are legible. Okay. Even for the smaller screens of handheld devices, you can adjust it accordingly. Okay. For example, you can use the max width property to ensure that the lines of the text do not appear too wide within a browser window. And you can use the min width property to make sure that they do not appear too narrow. Okay. So you have to specify fittingly with the case of max width as well as min width property. So this is an example of how you use the min width as well as max width. You have the table, row and table data. Okay, you can specify the image source. Okay. And TD class, you are going to give the description. The Rhodes piano is an electromechanical piano, so something like that you can display. And then TD is $1004. Right. So here if you can see, there is a description and there is price. So this is actually table data. Okay. So this is the table row. Okay. And then you have an image. Okay. And similarly, you have in CSS, you have TD description, minimum width 450 pixel, maximum width 650 pixel, text align, it is left align, and padding you are going to give us 5 pixel, margin 0 pixel. So similarly you can get the now in the image as well as the paragraph, and then you know the table data, the column, next column you have the price. So in the same way, you might want to limit the width of the box on a page, you might also want to limit the height of it. So you can use it by using, you can achieve it by using the min height as well as max height properties. So generally, it is going to demonstrate the properties in action, which means that the content of the box takes more space than the size specified for the box. Okay. So if the box is not big enough to hold the content and the content expands outside the box, generally it will not be looking good at. So to control what happens when there is not enough space for the content of the box, you can use the overflow property. So you can use the overflow property to fit the contents within a box so it doesn't overflow out of the box. So here this is an example. You have the
the H2 tag, okay, like Fender Mustang, you have a paragraph tag, H2, paragraph, H2, and paragraph. And CSS, you have like H2.b width, you can specify font size, line height, you can specify. And with the case of H2, color, border, and then you can specify. Paragraph tag, min height, and maximum height, you are going to specify. So this is how you specify the paragraphs. Okay, so you can specify what are the line spacing, height, what is the size, what is the color, like everything you can display. Like a Fender Mustang is displayed maybe in blue color. That's also you can do that with the case of CSS. So this is border, margin, and padding. So border, every box has a border. If it's not visible, it is specified with 0 pixels width. So the border separates the edge of one box from another. And then you have a margin which sits outside the edge of the border. You can set the width of the margin to create a gap between borders of two adjacent boxes. And you have a padding, which is nothing but the space between the border of a box and any content contained on it. For example, this is the border and this is the text. So this is actually the space. So this is actually what you call it to be padding. And this is margin. And this is actually the border. So if you specify width for a box, then the borders, margin, and padding are added to its width. So you have doc type HTML, an example, HTML title, you have the boxes, style type text slash CSS, body, you have font size 80%, font family, you are going to give it as Courier New, and then Courier Monospace, letter spacing 0.15 centimeter, background color, you are going to give a background color. Similarly, for the page, you can specify the maximum width, minimum width, margin, padding, border, background color. And with the case of logo, you can specify the width as well as margin. And unordered list, you can give the width, padding, margin, border, border bottom, and text alignment. So here you specify the text alignment as center. And with the case of list tag, you have the display inline, margin 0 pixel, 3 pixel. And paragraph, you are going to give it as text align center, width, margin, font. So this is how you specify the boxes, like text within a box, how you specify the alignment, the height, maximum width, everything you can specify. And the color for this one, text transform uppercase, text decoration, and padding you can specify. A over with the case of color and background. And finally, you are going to close the style and head tag. And of course, you are going to start with the body tag. So the body, you are going to give the div ID, space, or logo, for you are going to specify the source, okay, images slash logo.div, okay, and then you are going to close the div tag, and then unordered list, you are going to go with the ahref, home, for sale, repairs, about, and contact, okay. And then you are going to close the slash URL, paragraph tag, okay, and you are going to specify the source. Close the paragraph tag, and then again that's another paragraph also, a small paragraph, and then you close the paragraph tag, close the div element, body, as well as string. So on the output you will have like the analog specialist, which is displayed in a different font state, and then you have some tab, okay, like for say refers above. So you have like different images, and you have a text which is displayed in the center alignment. Okay. And, this is being displayed in a monospace letter format. I posted this independent work in the Google Classroom yesterday. I think you can go through this one.